Well, this is beginning a new message series for the month, and the message idea is relax. I mean, in June, we start thinking about vacations, right? We start thinking about if we don't live in Florida, we think about going to Florida. If we do live in Florida, we think about coming back to O'Fallon, like to the Tebows, who are right in front of me, just got back from, they're living in Florida most of the year. But, you know, where else can you think about relaxing and vacationing than O'Fallon, Missouri, when you live in Florida, right? When I think about the season of June and the summer season, I start thinking about vacations. And when I think about vacations, I think about how they give me a chance to relax. And it occurred to me that as I was getting ready for this message series, that we as a church and we as the people of God need to understand what one of the central ways to understand the gospel of Jesus Christ is to understand that when we receive the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we are given a spirit that relaxes. That it's very difficult to relax in so much of what's going on in our world and in just being human. And we miss, if we don't hear this, we miss the Spirit's ongoing whisper and presence to call us to a relaxed life. And so we're meant to receive this gift of the Spirit. As I think about where we're going this month, I think about how on this day we celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit that brings about the life of the church. The Spirit which comes to us, wants us to teach and guide us, and wants us to join together, connecting us to others who are also following the same Christ, serving the same God, and learning to live in the same Spirit. I think about how, as the people of God, we're meant to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ in this world today, living out the teachings of Christ, understanding how this is not just a faith we talk about on Sundays, but it's meant to be a seven-day-a-week faith we live out every day, and we support one another as people of God, as members of the same community of faith, joined together with other churches around this community and around the world, to recognize that we are receiving this great gift of new life through the Spirit of God. As I think about all this, I've got some ideas for you. I hope you'll join along with me in following along with what we've got going on. The first scriptural idea I have for us today is this: the Holy Spirit is God's constant presence with you and with me. The scripture that we read just a moment ago, thank you again to Jared Albrecht, always appreciate Jerry's reading. He's one of those guys that has a voice I wish I had. Where are you, Jerry? Where'd you go? There you are, Jerry. Thank you. You know, it's nice to be jealous right before a message. When I think about the Spirit of God being given to us, I think about this passage in Acts 2, where it talks about on a high holy day of celebration in the ancient Jewish world, as people who are following Christ were celebrating this day they call Pentecost, that something radically transformed that day for them and for every follower of Christ that follows them and is given birth to new life in Christ through their witness. And I think about how it's an amazing thing that we often don't think about in Acts 2, where there is this transformation of understanding about who Jesus is and who his ministry is to. When I think about the ministry of Jesus Christ, his life, his ministry, his death, his resurrection, and then his ascension into heaven, he promises to us that we won't be left alone or orphaned, that the Holy Spirit will be given to those who follow Christ. And what we have come to understand is that this gift of the Holy Spirit gives life to a church that is meant to be for all people. In chapter 2 of Acts, it talks about how people who all spoke the same language started speaking lots of different languages. It describes it again in verse 4. It said, in verse 3, it says, there were divided tongues as a fire appearing over all the followers of Christ who were in that room, and the tongues rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. It's an amazing moment where, as we look back on the birth of the church, we think about how the church was able to begin communicating the gospel of Jesus Christ to people in every corner of the world, regardless of what language is spoken or what culture is lived out and created by humanity, there is something about the gospel of Jesus Christ that is meant to be extended and taught to everyone. Because the presence of the Holy Spirit within us who are following Christ is meant to be shared with everyone. I think about how this gift of the Holy Spirit, this presence of God with us, it changes how we understand ourselves and how we think about what God wants us to do. Here at Cornerstone, we try to represent, embody, express to other people what it's like to have the Spirit of God with us. We start with the youngest kids that we have in our church. In fact, this image here shows our Kids Jam ministry that meets during the two worship services. This is one of the projects that we taught our kids to, what we had our kids do in order to teach them that the church is meant to be the physical presence of the spiritual gift of the Holy Spirit with us. These bags that they have in front of them are little gift bags that they asked me, they gave me more work by the way, the kids made these gift bags for people who are in the hospital and for their families that are with them while people are in the hospital. So I go and I still have a couple left. I take these gift bags to folks who are in the hospital and to their families that are staying there with them. And it's meant to be something that gives them comfort. Like there's some water, there's a little healthy snack in there, some kind of healthy little, it's not a candy bar because that would be too delicious. But it's something a healthy kind of, you know, kind of thing. And there's a little note journal pad that they get as well. And more than anything, it's a way for our kids to learn that being a follower of Christ is experiencing God with us, but then sharing with others what we've received from God, this gift of the Holy Spirit. But it's also a way to be compassionate to other people, to live out their faith. So, and then apparently it's also a way for the pastor to have one more thing to remember to do when he's working each day. So as I think about this this ministry we have to our children, I think about the next scriptural idea I have, which is the Holy Spirit's presence gives life and purpose to the church. So, you know, I heard a minister say famously once that he wasn't interested in playing church. That church isn't about just feeling good and it's not like a country club. It really is meant to have significant eternal purposes. When I think about our kids being taught right now how Jesus loves them, how they are meant to serve God, and how the Spirit of God wants to live in their hearts, and then teach them to love other people, I think about how each of us, as part of and as the church, is meant to live lives of great purpose, great eternal purpose. And our church is designed, and we are continuing to work to continue to design this church to have great eternal purposes that make a difference in everyday life so that people experience God's grace and people understand that Christian faith not only points us towards heaven, but teaches us we should live as if we were residents of heaven now. The next scripture idea I have is this: the church is equipped by the Spirit to go to all people. We are equipped to go to all people. Now, sometimes we don't realize we're equipped to go to all people. Sometimes we think, I can only take care of myself. And sometimes that's true. Right? There are some times when our greatest purpose is to take care of ourselves. We may not always feel good about that, but that's sometimes the case. I had someone who was in their 90s recently say to me, I feel bad that I can't do what I used to do. And I said to the person, I am training in the gym every day to be as active and as clear-minded, clear-headed, and as spiritually purposeful as you are. You are an inspiration to me. When people see me in the gym, they ask me what I'm training for, and I name one of our 90-year-olds and say, I'm training to be them. They say, who's that person? I say, well, that person is 93 and they're in church every Sunday. So sometimes we don't understand our purpose as people of God. But each of us is equipped, whether it's to take care of ourselves, to be an inspiration to others, or it is to go out into the world. We're equipped as a church to go to all people, not just people who are in our neighborhood, or in the city of O'Fallon, or in the county of St. Charles, or in the greater metro area of St. Louis, we're equipped to go to all the world. We have someone, we have a couple of folks in our church that are in the process of going out into the world. The person in the upper left there is Casey Winter, and she's collecting white t-shirts that she's going to be taking to kids in Nicaragua as part of a mission trip to those children in Nicaragua. She's teaching us that we can live better by faith in a country where we may not even be able to communicate easily through the barrier of different languages. And then the person on the lower right-hand corner is Bing Benir, and this is an image of Bing when she went to her native Philippines and visited family and friends in the neighborhood she grew up in. She handed out Bibles in the native Filipino language to just people she met. She talks about how when she went to those different folks and would have a Bible in their native language, that she had people of all ages, people in their 90s, people that were 9, and everyone in between asking them for a Bible. This year she's getting ready to take, I think it's double the number of Bibles she took in her last trip. And she's taking her husband Tom to go with her, and they're going to do the same thing again, taking Bibles to the people in the Philippines. She's also planning a trip to Honduras. In fact, I think she's on that trip right now. And her plan is to come back and tell us about that mission trip to Honduras and talk to us, our missions team, about the possibility of us as a church doing an international mission trip. We have, as a church, been very active in mission work to FAR Texas, to a town of FAR Texas, and also to different mission-needed organization or communities within a day's drive of our church. We've had lots of different mission projects that we have done here. We haven't done, as far as I know, a lot of international trips. And so these two folks who are part of us are reminding us that the Spirit of God equips us to go to all people, to sometimes step outside of our comfort zone, to share the love of Christ and the message that Jesus is the resurrected Son of God, and to show people that there is a compassionate God who lives inside of us, who gives us strength to demonstrate and to explain in ways people understand who Jesus is. God is preparing you and me to reach out to all people. I think this is a tough message, to be honest with you, that we are actually equipped to go to all people. It's difficult to believe sometimes, because the challenges of reaching out to other people, well, they're many, and they're varied. Everything from we live in different communities, to we dress in different ways, to we like different kinds of music, to we are different ages, to we are different skin colors, to we speak different languages. You know, even in the United States, if you go to different parts of Virginia, there are several different dialects of Virginia. Sometimes it's tough within Virginia to communicate. If you go to different places in Missouri, sometimes I wonder, how in the world is that person from Missouri? They start by saying Missouri, and then it just gets worse from there. And of course, everyone in my side of the family says to me, why do you say Missouri? It's Missouri. What did we do wrong, is what they say to me. I'm a native here in Missouri. Communicating can be challenging. There are lots of different reasons that we tell ourselves we can't go out into the world. We can't connect to other people. And we forget that the Spirit of God resides in us and is giving us, the Church of Cornerstone, the people of the Church of Cornerstone, the spiritual ability to go out into the world and share the love of Christ and the message of God's eternal love with whoever we're called to. My next scriptural idea is this, that God wants us to receive the Spirit's gifts, graces, purposes, and presence. We often think about the gift of Jesus Christ to begin and end with eternal life. And we think that's really what the church is all about. But I'm telling you, we are meant to live better by faith today. Not just imagine Christian faith as some kind of life insurance policy for eternity. I mean, it's great to know that we can live eternity with God, but if we fail to minister to our brother or sister now, if we fail to reach out to the person who needs God's care and love and grace now, are we really citizens of heaven? The message of Jesus Christ is a message for now, not for the future, although it is for the future as well. There is this future drawing us to it, this truth about God's ongoing work. This scripture speaks to us though, about how we are meant to receive the Spirit of God. And when we receive that Spirit, we receive gifts, spiritual gifts that help us to be part of the body of Christ, the church, and to minister in ways that express God's grace. We are meant to have purposes that live out these good gifts and graces. And we are meant to be literally the presence of God in the world. There's no better way for me to explain all of this than for me to think about what's right in front of you, and that is Holy Communion. Here at Cornerstone, we believe that Holy Communion is a way, is a sacrament to explain the mystery of God's work in the world. When you think about communion, who do you think I should not serve the communion to? As your pastor, who would you want me not to give God's grace to? Because the sacrament of Holy Communion is an expression of God's grace. We say, as part of the United Methodist Church and here at Cornerstone, that the table for communion is open to everyone. The reason for that? God's grace is being offered every moment to everyone. So who should we keep this grace from? And if the communion table is open to everyone, what about the ministry of compassion? What about the opportunity to invite someone into the church in order for them to learn to grow in faith? What about the opportunity for someone to learn that there is a gift of saying yes to God and receiving the Spirit, and that gift leads to a different way of life, of caring for others in the church and outside the church? Holy Communion teaches us that God's grace is not meant to be something that is kept from other people, but offered to all. It's meant to help us understand we are united in love through Jesus Christ when we are connected through communion, that there is a communion beyond just the communion table. It's the ongoing relationships between God and God's people to one another. And then finally, when I think about this gift, I think about which one of us has been perfected in God's grace and can stand above the others and say, I am better than everyone else. Communion teaches us that God is never done working in us, that there are things about other people we may not like, and there may be things about us that other people don't like. It's tough for me to imagine there's anything about me as your pastor that you wouldn't like about me. I have to really imagine hard. Holy Communion reminds each of us that the God of love sends Jesus Christ to die for us, and that in that resurrection, Jesus sends the Spirit of God to each of us, to live inside of us, to give us the experience of eternal life that is an ongoing, growing gift. But Holy Communion also teaches us that all of us are equal in God's eyes. All of us are in need of the same forgiveness, an ongoing gift of God's grace that leads us to grow in faith in different ways, but that God's never done with us. I've been a pastor for almost 23 years now, as an ordained minister. I have yet to preach to a perfect person in the church. Hope you'll think of that for a second. 23 years of ministry. I've ministered in Missouri and in Virginia. I've ministered in several different congregations. I have yet to meet one person who I would say is perfected in love. That starts with me. Each of us, not yet complete, not yet perfect, each still needing God's ongoing grace and love. Holy Communion reminds us that we all need the same gift of grace. And that leads to the last scriptural idea for today, which is that accepting the Spirit's leadership leads the church to relax. When we receive the Spirit of God and we allow the Spirit of God to lead us, when we really trust God's Spirit, when the Scriptures become real to us more and more every day, we learn to relax. We hear the risen Christ say to us, peace be with you. This morning, as you receive Holy Communion, I pray that you would hear the Spirit whisper to you, relax, peace be in your heart. We pray for you. Today, God, open us up to your good gift of grace. Help us to see that you're with us. May we receive the good gifts the Spirit will bring. And may we relax. In your Son's name I pray. Amen.